Game of Thrones is the most Emmy Award-winning scripted series of all time, a global pop culture sensation, the most ambitious TV production ever mounted, and has been coming to Comic-Con since 2011. Yay. But this year is different. This year is special because for the first time, all the spoilers are out, all the endings are known, there is nothing the cast cannot talk about. And we're going to ask about a lot of your burning questions about the final season. So I'd like for you to give a huge welcome to the final Game of Thrones Comic-Con panel. We're going to bring him out right now. He's an honorable man, whether he likes it or not. As Jaime Lannister, it's Nikolaj Coster-Waldau. Our new master of ships as Davos Seaworth, it's Liam Cunningham. He was commander of the Unsullied as Grey Worm, it's Jacob Anderson. A girl has no equal. As Arya Stark, it's Maisie Williams. As our new Grand Maester of the Six Kingdoms, Samwell Tarly, it's John Bradley. He was master of whispers and right all along as Varys. It's Conleth Hill. And finally, hail to the king as Bran Stark. It's Isaac Hempstead Wright.
Someone left some coffee cups here.
It's Dornish wine.
So first off, congratulations to all of you with Game of Thrones being nominated for 32 Emmys this week, including Best Supporting Actor nods for Nikolaj and Maisie.
Dude.
The single most nominated series season in TV history. Isaac, since you're a new king, let's start with you. You know, perhaps the biggest question from the start of the show was who would end up in the Iron Throne. And the closest answer to that question ended up being Bran Stark. So since the finale has aired, have fans reacted any differently to you? You know, what's that been like for you?
It's been great. I mean, Bran was always kind of a bit of a periphery character. He was never really involved in the main sort of action for many seasons. And all of a sudden, he's the king, so it was pretty cool. I've forced my family and friends to now refer to me only as Your Grace. So remember that, everyone.
And in the world of Game of Thrones, where the story is continuing, how do you imagine that Bran Stark's first couple months in office have gone? What has he accomplished so far?
I mean, I can't imagine his government is a barrel of laughs. I think it might be quite serious. And I guess, to all intents and purposes, Westeros is now a surveillance state, with Bran aware of everything that everyone's doing, so, yeah.
You know, do you think he ended up finding Drogon, and if so, what did he do with him?
Burn a couple of sissies down, so got back, get the revenge.
Let's see. Along those lines, Maisie, as you know, what do you, how do you imagine that Arya's backpacking tour is going now she's out in the world?
Thank you. I'm sure she's having a wonderful time. Like Dora the Explorer. Minus the bob. But maybe she's cut a bob in, you know? West of Westeros might like the bob, so who knows?
Probably a little more stabby than Dora, I'd imagine.
Yeah.
You know, it occurred to me afterwards that she could have just asked Bran what is west of Westeros, and he could have told her. But where would be the fun in that, right?
That was like my favorite meme, actually. We're like, what's west of Westeros? And it's like, no one knows. And then Bran's there like, are you kidding me?
And Jacob, how do you imagine the Grey Worm's move to Nap went? I picture him just kind of chilling on a beach at this point.
Yeah, I mean, I think he's just like starting a new society, like Wakanda kind of vibe in another part of the world. People keep telling me that butterflies killed him. they get there and there's poisonous butterflies. But I think he's keeping his promise to Missandei and he's sitting on the beach drinking pina coladas and protecting everyone.
You know, a colleague of mine asked me to ask this follow-up question. I said, no, that's too sappy, I won't ask it, but I'm just going to do it anyway. Do you think that he could find love again?
What's the right answer? No, not in the same way, no. I think that was a one-time deal, really. Yeah.
You'll be miserable forever.
What's new?
You're miserable forever, are you happy now? Okay, so John and Liam, I want a spin-off where we just watch the day-to-day business of the new small council as they deal with, like, you know, King's Landing budgetary issues and property taxes. You know, how do you imagine life has been like in that new small council?
I imagine relationships have soured by now, right? Relationships must have soured by now to some degree. I think that one of the nice things about that final scene was that when we leave that and we leave them bickering amongst themselves and we've kind of set up a slightly more comic space with Davos and Bronn butting heads all the time and Sam just trying to be the voice of reason. I felt personally, even though I was directly involved, that you want to stay with them. There's so much drama involved in a group of people who just don't like each other, but they're forced to exist. It basically turns into The Office, right? It basically turns into a sitcom, and it's kind of humanity in microcosm, that you think that they're all fighting towards the same aim and fighting for the greater good, but if you don't like the guy who's opposite you while you're doing that, then it's not going to be an easy life for anybody.
I think it's definitely a step up from what was there. I'm not as pessimistic as you. I think it's a wonderful thing. The group of people around the table were quite, you know, I thought that was a nice end to the small council and King's Landing. I'm eternally optimistic. And I did mention about the spin-off. You did mention, I think it should be Better Call Davos. Just a suggestion. It's $1,000 idea.
And for those of you who didn't quite make it to the end of the show, Nikolai, I would argue that the end of Jaime Lannister is actually not when he's buried under the Red Keep's rubble or even when his brother finds him, but rather when Bran writes in the White Book that he died protecting his queen. That even though your character's off screen in that moment, that's kind of the real end point for his character. You know, now that some more time has passed since from the finale, you know, how is his end sitting with you?
It's sitting the same way it did when it aired and when we shot. I thought it was a great ending. I thought it was perfect for that character's end in the arms of Cersei. It made sense to me.
always won.
Oh, that's just my opinion. But I think for me the scene with Gwendolyn Christie as Brienne when she fills in the blanks in the book was really beautiful. And I think that showed her understanding of Jaime and the love of Jaime. And I thought that was just a beautiful scene.
Yeah.
And Conleth.
Yes, sir.
We did an interview for EW when you're on set and you're like still in character and you're still very much in the story. And that interview got a lot of attention. It got a lot of pickup. You were very candid about your feelings about the final season. And internet being internet, you know, I think it kind of got, some of those quotes got kind of cherry-picked and put onto other sites and kind of pushed perhaps a bit further than you intended. You know, I got the feeling you kind of wanted to address that a bit and maybe some more time has passed. How are you now feeling about the end of Varys?
Well, I don't regret starting the petition. Now, to be very honest, I did an interview with EW way after we'd finished the show, and the question was, how did you feel at the time? And I was very honest that I was absolutely gutted to get so close but not make the end. But then I, what?
No one. It's inside your head.
Nobody else in the voice? Assholes. So, I thought I gave a very honest answer to how I felt, but I put it in the context of that was one of the risks in being in a multi-character show, and I thought the whole initial interview was very balanced, but as you say, it was picked over like a whale on a beach, and they took all the negative out of it and didn't put any of the positive in. So for the record, I loved all my 10 years on Game of Thrones. I started when I was 15. Shut your face. Not funny. And it was a life-changing experience, and I met wonderful people on and off screen who I worked with, who were beautiful inside and out. And the one thing that last series was about was the futility of conflict and the pointlessness of war. And if that, you get one thing from that whole show, take that, because it doesn't work.
While we're on the topic of the reaction, you know, I do want to get into that a little bit because, you know, Cersei didn't get her elephants, but that is the elephant in the room. You know, when I spoke to each of you on the set, I got the feeling everyone was expecting a certain percentage of fan upset over the final season, either because you obviously can't please everybody and also because a certain, you know, scripted things were pretty much intended to be divisive. But I don't think anyone expected the level of blowback that there was. So for whoever wants to tackle it, you know.
I don't think it was, you look at the amount of people who are here, and we're here to thank you for watching us for all those years.
Yes.
We were never divisive as a cast. We didn't fight among each other. We always did our hardest work and crew for you. And so we're very grateful for your fandom over the years. And I think this is the reality rather than a sort of media-led hate campaign. It wasn't
also,
really
rare. But also remember, it's like every... It was... Yeah, it was surprising the level of, I mean, the absurdity of it. Online petition.
Yes.
Of course, the HBO are going to change the whole thing. Yes.
Yeah.
Because that's the power of the internet. But every season we had huge controversies. And there was like, from Ned Stark being killed, it was like, I'm never going to watch that piece of shit show again. Terrible. And then there was the Red Wedding, and I never, I mean, there was every season. And I think, obviously, the end, in a show that, I mean, I think it's been, I feel so lucky to have met so many people just here, but also fans of the show, and realizing that this show has brought so many people together, watching it, loving it. So obviously, if it comes to an end, it's gonna piss you off no matter what.
Yeah.
Because it's the end. That's so hard. And of course, but at the end of the day, it's absolutely fine. I mean, you know, it's if you hated the ending, if you loved it, if there, I mean, that's great. Just don't call people names.
Okay. Yeah. And you have to remember, it's almost a metaphor for life. It's not arriving at the end that's the point of this whole thing. It was the journey. And again, to go back to the all of us in, here in this room and the millions of fans, and we reckon, like I started in the beginning of season two when it just started to create waves, and to watch that grow, and to be on the set when we were doing the work, and the reason you guys are here is because you could recognize the amount of love that we had in making this show, and we and you were all on this journey together. We weren't just delivering something we thought was nice or good or great to you. We didn't know where it was going to go. Nobody knew how big it was going to get. And all of us here feel absolutely blessed to have been part of it, as much as we're all fans of the show. We all get our little bit. And we're all huge fans of the show. You have to be. It's a beautiful, beautiful storytelling. And I'm blessed to be a part of it and blessed to watch it.
And I think that's it. If it's not the story you want, it doesn't make it any less valid.
Is there anything with the benefit of hindsight that you wish had been done differently?
I should have been on the throne. Isn't it obvious?
Yes, Liam's agent.
Actually, it's my publicist.
Speaking of endings, I want to get into some specific burning questions about the final season for each of you that I'm actually quite excited to ask. You know, Nikolaj, you've strongly defended Jaime's choice to return to Cersei as exactly what his character would do based on everything that we've previously seen. But if Jaime had somehow survived being stabbed by Euron and being covered in rubble, and Cersei had not, do you think that a relationship with
Then we
Brienne...
would have shipped Jaime. Yes. It would have been Brienne and Jaime forever and ever.
Are you being serious? Because your character was very much like bit divided on that, saying, oh no, this couldn't work because I'm too morally far gone. We're too morally different.
I think he's got a lot of baggage, and I think she would probably find out after a few weeks, and she'd go, no, I'm going to have to move on to someone else.
Okay.
It's too complicated. Tormund, yes.
Like you and Tormund?
No. Yeah.
I like the idea of that. That works for me.
A Scandi couple, yes.
Liam, Davos vowed to kill Melisandre, and then she came back and saved the day and killed herself. But if she hadn't walked off into the suicide sun and instead came up to you after the battle and was like, hey, how do you like me now? Would Davos still have been able to go through killing her in cold blood after she just helped save so many lives? No, can't, don't help him.
I see we've got a few psychiatric patients in here this evening. It's a really good question. I it was one of those things that I kind of ran through my own mind when you're kind of preparing for the for those scenes. I'm not sure. He was described by some people as the moral compass of the piece, and you never saw him killing anybody or...
We're all laughing at that.
I didn't say Liam.
You described.
Myself and Davos aren't exactly similar. I think he'd have wanted to have done it, but whether he would or not, I think his humanity was always kind of rose to the surface. I would like to think he'd have got someone else to do it. Now that he's a lord. Don't forget, I got a promotion. I'm not Sir Davos anymore. I'm Lord Davos.
The moral compass.
It was a bit of a stretch.
And Jacob, one of the burning questions fans had after the finale was, after Jon Snow killed Daenerys, why didn't Grey Worm kill Jon Snow when he discovered what he did? Because he was killing everybody else. You know, I'm curious if there was a reason you were told back channel or a reason you worked out for your character as to why he didn't take out Jon after he confessed to killing Daenerys.
It's a good question. I think that there is, like, in my head, I think there maybe came a point for Grey Worm towards the end where it was just like enough is enough. I think that's a big reason why he kind of left was it was like everybody that was ever dear to him was dead now.
Yeah.
And he'd already just learned how to have people be dear to him. And so I think he just wanted to get it. It was like, this is a violent place and this is not what I want my existence to be anymore. I don't just want it to be violent. So I think there's a sense that he was willing for there to be a trial. He wasn't just trying to like kill everyone anymore. I don't think he wants necessarily to kill Jon Snow. He just doesn't want him to be alive.
Yeah. I mean, if I was Jon Snow and Grey Worm walked in, I'd be like, hey, crazy thing, the murder dragon just killed Daenerys and took off with her. Who knows if they'll be back? Because after that, everybody in King's Landing would have been down for blaming the dragon.
Yeah. Standing there.
Conleth, this one I'm pretty sure I know the answer to, but you know, it's one of those things that I think a lot of people missed at the very least. At the start of his final episode, a kitchen girl tells Varys that Dany won't eat, and he tells her to try again at supper. Mm-hmm. It's a cryptic exchange, but Varys is, I mean, he's trying to kill, he's trying to poison Dany there, right? Was that what his
opinion? Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Okay, James. Can I call you James?
Sure.
Once he decides she's gonna kill, you know, he's not wrong. She's the coin when a Targaryen's born is going to be one side or the other, and hers has come down a bit cray-cray towards the end. And so I think Varys knew long ago he was going to die, and what the sorcerer might have said to him might have been what she says, you know, when he's burnt to death. So I think there was an inevitability about he knew that he couldn't get through to Jon Snow or to Tyrion because they were both in love with Daenerys, and that blinds people's judgments. So he knew that he had to try anyway to stop her, and that it was very possibly be killed. So I thought it was a cool death, and very dignified, and I swear the dragon thought twice about it. If you watch it again, he kind of goes, wait, what? Okay. You know, I'm happy with that. There are ways to get fired, and that was one of the best.
Awesome. Isaac, you might have heard this theory going around, the evil Bran theory. This is the theory that Bran, because he knows what's going to happen, he kind of sat back and let Daenerys creme brulee torch King's Landing, and then get killed by Jon as a way of seizing the throne for himself. And I'm wondering what you think of that.
Well, I don't think Bran knows per se exactly what's going to happen in the future. I don't think he's not a fortune teller. He's got the entirety of the past at his fingertips, but I think his sort of vision of the future is slightly cloudier. So that's my excuse for why Bran didn't say anything. But I think it's quite cool that it's left slightly ambiguous and that you can read into it. I've read loads of things where like Bran is actually still the Night King or whatever, and yeah, you can sort of read into those situations and think, wow, has Bran just sort of sat back and let the Starks win, or is he really, you know, a bad guy all along? And I think that's kind of what was one of the cleverest things about the ending, is that it doesn't conclude everything very neatly. You don't have your sort of set endings and, you know, you can sit back and go, right, well, this happened to them, this happened to them. It's left totally open. You know, the kingdom's in total disarray. Arya's going off to start her own journey. Sansa's now queen. Bran is king. And they're storylines that could, you know, warrant their own spin-off. But they don't. But they're left in, you know, they're not finished, there's no full stop, there's no period. So it's almost as if the world of Game of Thrones exists still somewhere in the ether, which I think is quite nice, that it's not finished conclusively. It lets you kind of read into it, like with the evil Bran.
And while we all hope you have a very long reign, who would you want to succeed you?
Ooh, well, I mean, if the lifespans of previous Three-Eyed Ravens were anything to go by, it's not going to be anyone succeeding Bran for a couple of thousand years. So will be no one alive at the moment. I don't know. I think it'd be fun. Maybe the Night King's still knocking about somewhere, and he'll pop up when Bran dies. And like, you can carry on, mate.
And Maisie, I saved you for last in this round, but I have two for you. First, is Arya let down poor Gendry as sweetly as Arya being Arya could? But if after she's like toured around a little bit and come back and visit Sansa, does he have any chance?
I think Arya has always been a lone wolf. I think she's always felt like a bit of a misfit in her own family. And I don't think being with a partner is what would make her feel the most at home or the most fulfilled. So I think that was kind of what that whole exchange was. It was just trying to understand that and know that it isn't necessarily what she wants. Which is like an important learning curve for everyone, I think. So they probably like see each other at like a friend's wedding and be like, oh, hey, like, it's good to see you. How you been? And then they're like, oh yeah, like, so good. And you're like, cool.
So Gary shuffling around. And another one for you. You know, after Arya killed the Night King, some Jon Snow fans insisted that one reason she did this was because they thought Jon Snow was yelling, go, 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 and he was distracting the Ice Dragon so Arya could run in and make her move. So let's settle this. Did Arya run in and kill the Night King on her own, or was Jon Snow helping her and she was doing what Jon Snow was telling her to do?
She did it on her own.
Yeah!
Credit to anyone, then it's Melisandre. Melisandre knew what she had to do to put the mission in Arya's head when she's really at like the lowest point. I think particularly for that episode, this is the first time that she's been fighting, but now she has something to lose. For so long she's been on her own, and being back with her family has made her that much more vulnerable. And I think if we're gonna, you know, put it down to anyone for getting Arya's head back on track and helping her to like go and finish the job, it was Melisandre and the brown eyes, blue eyes, green eyes, blue eyes, all the eyes.
So now that the series is over, for each of you, I'm wondering, what is your all-time favorite line from the show? Could be your character, could be another character. But what is your all-time favorite line? There's so many quotable lines. Let's start with Nikolaj and kind of go down the line here.
My favorite was the line when we found out why Hodor was Hodor. So hold the door, Hodor. My favorite.
Ooh. Liam?
I've been really lucky. There's so many beautiful lines in this show, but I can... one of the favorite Davos lines is, and put your fingers in your ears, nothing fucks you harder than time.
Oh, for God.
I think that's magnificent and so true. They were like that to me all the time on the set, all the time.
Jake?
I'm not like, I know this is really obvious, but Valar Morghulis is like, I think it's such a, it's a very obvious statement, all men must die, but I think it kind of encapsulates the show in a really powerful way.
Well, thanks for that.
I just think it sounds cool. Liam, you're welcome to...
Thank you. Next.
I'm going to selfishly choose one of my own lines. I really liked Not Today. I have nothing to add.
I'm going to pick one of my own as well. And I've always liked lines of dialogue that tell a complete story outside of their own, the own entity that is the sentence. And when I first read the line, I always wanted to be a wizard, back in season one, I just thought, oh, that's a funny line. I like, I, it But I think the more you learn about Sam, the more you realise what a story that line tells about his childhood. Because you're dealing with somebody who whose childhood was so tough and so hard and so brutal and unforgiving that he had to create this alternative reality for himself to exist in. And he always wanted to be a wizard because he always wanted to be something other than what he was. He always wanted, I just have this idea of him going to bed and, you know, waking up and I'm still the same. I've not changed. And I would give him anything to change.
Wow.
And that, those kind of worlds are created by people who find reality tough and find the body that they inhabit a tough place to inhabit. So it's not just, it's a funny line on the surface, but the more you learn about him, the more you learn about his childhood, his relationship to his former self and the journey that he goes on, you realise that that tells you everything you need to know about what he came from and what he's grown out of.
Hi. I think RuPaul Drag Race Series 3 was...
Oh, it has to be from this series.
Oh, okay. I loved I Drink and I Know Things.
Definitely a fan.
And that wasn't one of my lines. Good night, everyone.
The brilliant Peter Dinklage is Tyrion. Yeah. I Drink and I Know Things.
Amazing.
I think this is kind of one of my lines. It was originally Littlefinger's, and it was in that great exchange between Varys and Littlefinger. And the whole speech is brilliant, but when he says chaos is a ladder, I think that kind of sums up a lot of the world of Game of Thrones and how you get ahead in it. And I especially love that because I got to repeat that back to Littlefinger in a scene, which and it's not often you put Littlefinger on the back foot. So that was something really fun to get to do as an actor.
Fantastic. Yo, Liam, you recently confessed to pilfering a bunch of Game of Thrones props over the years.
It was bigger than a bunch.
The list includes a Dothraki sword, a Davos' finger bone bag. It says here money, I'm assuming prop money and not actual embezzlement from the production company. And a hand-carved stag, which I assumed belonged to Shireen, so you kind of took it from her too. too soon. I'm surprised HBO didn't shorten your fingers for this, but since they didn't, I'm wondering if anybody else in the panel wants to confess to taking something, not being given something, not as a gift, but taking something from the production that they were not supposed to.
I took the stuff they took as well.
On my very last day on Game of Thrones, I thought, I've got to take something. So I ran through the set I was on, which was actually not even a set I'd ever filmed on. I was doing a promotional shoot for EW, and I just grabbed whatever I could. And so after spending 10 years on Game of Thrones, I've left with a wooden spoon. Very practical.
I stole most of the scenes I was in.
God, now you have to follow that.
Me?
Yeah.
No, I didn't take anything. I've never taken anything. And it's so weird. You can test how well people have been paying attention to the show sometimes because I keep saying, and it's true, I've never taken anything because I have a pathological fear of getting in trouble. Like I just can't deal with the idea of being in trouble or being to blame for something. And the people say, oh, he's exactly like Samwell in that regard. And you think, have you been paying attention? Samwell steals everything. Samwell's a klepto. You don't leave anything around Samwell. He's stolen books and swords.
And ruined them as well.
He's defaced books. He's not... he's not a good guy. Light-fingered Samwell Tarly. He stole a baby? Did he? Oh, well, he stole a baby. I didn't steal Gilly either. You can't steal her. She's a person, not a goat. Come on. Pay attention. I almost stole a baby.
Maisie, what about yourself?
Is she still stolen any babies at all that you can remember?
She stole our hearts.
I didn't really steal anything, but when we were doing the scene where Arya's taken the waif's face and she's putting it back in the Hall of Faces, and there's this trail of blood. So as like they could do the resets really easily, they use these little like silicone like blobs of blood so as it wouldn't like slip all over the floor, but they just stay. And I took a bunch of those and like left them all over the bathroom of my trailer.
Something wrong with you.
Like, why the sink?
Let's leave that there, shall we? James, if you wouldn't mind moving on.
You're back in the room.
Well, let's see. Okay. Let's go to this one. Is there anything you were told about your characters, either from the showrunners or from George R.R. Martin, that didn't make it into the show? Any sort of piece of backstory or something that you thought might happen or whatnot?
Oh yeah, when we did the fight against Mance Rayder with Stannis. I was on the back of a horse swinging a sword, and we had very little time left to do it, and I did these wonderful swings and killed a couple of soldiers, and then the next season they came along and said, actually, he's not much of a fighter, we're going to drop all that, and I took it away. And then they spent the entire rest of the season saying how crap I was at fighting. So I was kind of emasculated with that one, and they knew it hurt me, so they did it more. Yeah, they're evil, these guys. Yeah, but I did kill a couple of guys early on. It was small, but from the back of a horse, I thought I was doing marvelously. I'm not doing the reshoot of season 8. I'm not doing it. No way. I would have, but not now.
I got told one thing.
Oh yeah?
The last time I'm ever gonna say this. Dick, no balls.
Oh.
That was what they told me. Sorry to be
impressed.
Wow,
that changed.
No, that was fun.
Ew. That's actually how Jacob was described, not his character. Good night, everybody. I'm kidding. This guy.
Wow. Okay.
Should we take some questions?
I'm actually not going to ask about these coffee cups just because I just feel that's been talked to death. But what I was going to ask about was the modern day water bottle.
Oh, great.
That ended up on the set in the finale because that was right next to your leg, John.
Was it?
Right? What was your reaction after the finale when that photo started circulating everywhere?
Well, interesting you should ask this question now after that whole pathological fear of getting in trouble shtick that I came out with. But no, I've always been somebody who's taken a lot of kind of, or felt a lot of responsibility for things and felt a lot of blame for things. Mm. And so when I saw it, even though, you know, even if it was my, I will say this actually, can I just say this, that I'm right-handed. I've thought about this very, very strongly. I'm right-handed. So if I had, if I'm drinking a water bottle with this hand, my right hand, right? If I was gonna put it on the floor, I think I'd put it on this side of my leg, right? But the bottle was on this side. So, as a conspiracy theory, I'm not trying to clear my name here too forcefully, but I will say that there's a guy on this side who might be kind of right-handed as well. I think I've taken enough blame for this. No, not a name and shame.
Liam.
So hold on.
No, it's not.
And Jacob was standing up, I think.
Yeah, do you know what? Good point, actually.
I don't drink water.
Yeah, good point. But yeah, I just did, when it was circulating, I was thinking, oh my God, the episode's been ruined and it's all my fault. Pardon me for being thirsty. Maybe give me a costume that's not quite so heavy in Spain. And then I wouldn't need to drink quite so much water. No, but I think there were several stages in between that day and it being on TV where that could have been gotten rid of.
Yeah.
It could have been spotted and could have been taken out. But
the Samwell doth protest too much.
I like that it was kind of half hidden. It was like kind of half behind the chair leg, like it was kind of half scooched back there,
kind of poking his head out. Yeah, trying to get on telly.
Well, I have one more question before we go to fan questions.
Okay.
What will you miss most about playing your character? Not working on the show, because you know people always say, "Oh, the cast and crew," but what will you miss most about playing the character that you play? Nikolaj, would you like to start?
The money.
Don't embarrass me here, Nikolaj.
What do I miss the most about playing Jaime? It was a cast and crew. Yeah, the gold hand. God, I wish I missed that gold hand. No, it is. The truth is, it is the people. I mean, I know you'd like me to say, oh, it was the, I don't know what you want me to say. It really was. I miss working with these guys, you know, coming back every year to Belfast. The crew, that's what this is. It was a human, the interaction, that's what we carry with us, and we will always carry that with us. Yeah, so.
It was a very strange thing. There's very few jobs that you go onto, they're like hen's teeth, that everybody that's on the set is like incredibly wonderful at their job. It's like a perfect storm. We had these beautiful words that we were handed by George, David and Dan, and you're working with these crews who are incredibly quiet and efficient and precise, the props, the costume, and there was a kind of a magical sense of it, and we had these incredibly long scenes that were so right, these words were so right for those characters and everything else, and it's a very, very rare that something that comes along that is almost, that feels almost faultless, that feels almost gorgeous, and it was just, every day was a pleasure to go to work. I miss the elegance of it and working with people who are at the absolute top of their game, and I'll be very, very lucky if I come across that ever again.
I don't think I could say it better than these two in terms of our family that we've made making this show. And it's just the mundane things about getting up in the morning and hanging out in the makeup truck is so fun. I miss that so much every day. In terms of a character thing, I have like a very chaotic mind, and I can be very restless, and I talk too much, and I laugh at everything, and I'm quite a panicky person. And for like, sometimes for like 5 to 10 minutes during a scene, I get to be this person who's so in control of themselves and is so still and calm. And that's been a really powerful thing for me, to even just to be able to do that. That's like that's been really special. I didn't know that I'd be able to like fall into that. And I don't think I've quite realized that until sort of now, that sort of this far removed from it, that was a really important thing for me and my head. And also I'm gonna miss spear fights. I love spear fighting.
Along the same like vein as that, I don't think that I'll ever be able to play a character that picks up a dagger without people going, "You played Arya, so that's, you know." So like doing all of the combat fighting and like working with swords and doing something of this time period, like I'll really miss that. I don't think I'll ever do anything like that again for fear of just repeating myself. So yeah, that's been incredible, and I've really loved it.
Yeah, just for me, very similar sentiments about missing the people and missing that family unit and that team spirit and everything. But I think in terms of playing Sam specifically, what I'm going to mainly miss is charting that progress that he's made. If you take a character who, when he first comes into it, is somebody who has been told his entire life, I've said it before, but he's completely worthless, he's never going to achieve anything, he's never going to change the world, he's only ever going to be a passenger and a dead weight. And over the course of those 8 seasons, you see this process of self-discovery and just realizing just how much worth he has, and he finishes up in a place where he's Archmaester, and his opinion is valued, and he's valued because of the things that make him him. He's not had to change anything about himself to become valued, and I think that if you take that journey, and how unlikely that would be when you first meet him and he's got no self-esteem, to become such a valuable part of the ruling of this kingdom, then who knows what he could achieve next? That journey itself is just so unlikely, and I'm going to miss charting that very, very gradual journey from season one to where we leave him. So, you know, given another 8 seasons, he could achieve literally anything he wants, and I'm going to miss charting that journey, I think.
This show began 10 years into a peace process in Northern Ireland after about 30 years of conflict. And I couldn't be prouder that it was made in a large part in the place where I was from, but what I'm most proud of is the collection of all kinds of different people, young, old, gay, straight, black, white, male, female, Muslim, Jewish, Christian, who all work together so well and so productively, and to the credit of my homeland. And it showed you how beautiful it is there and how we can work together in peace. So I invite you all to visit us and do the Game of Thrones tours. But most of all, I want to thank you all for watching for 10 years, 8, yeah. 9, 10 years, and keeping us on TV. Thank you so much.
In terms of playing Bran, I think in the last 2 seasons it was so fun and such an interesting exercise to have to be so still and calm. It's actually quite a strange thing to do for sort of 8 hours a day, sit there during takes where there are all sorts of crazy things going on, like fights going around you, and you just have to sit there and sort of observe. You know, it was almost sort of meditative and quite a fun experience that forced you to sort of reflect. But in general, I think what I'm going to miss most about the show, and I'm not just saying this because I'm in a room full of 6,000 fans, but it is the fans. Being part of a show the people absolutely love and theorize about and draw pictures of and come up with stories about. You kind of take it for granted when you're in it, and you forget just how many people are following what you do for a living on a daily basis. And it's been such a special, unique experience to be part of something that has brought so many people joy and brought so many people together, as Nikolaj said. And I think that's something we'll all miss so much. And yeah, as Conleth said, thank you for supporting us for 10 years.
And I'm getting the signal to wrap, so that is all the time we have. I'm sorry we didn't get a chance to get fan questions. That's my fault, by the way. But thank you for coming out. Thank you for coming out here for the final Game of Thrones Comic-Con panel. And let's give a warm round of applause for the cast of Game of Thrones.